Okay, good morning!
Have you ever came across how to define your noting style,
pick a perfect note-taking app,
videos, and still don't know where to start? I know I'm not the first person to make one of those videos, but those videos take intense amount of planning.
Creativity, blocking out your time.
Coming from an unmotivated, lazy, realistic person, here are my principles, and yes, they are evidence-backed up tips, and let's get into it!
Yeah!
First is that humans are naturally lazy.
This comes back to the days when we need resources to survive and reproduce. Laziness might work in the past, but now, in the 21st century, it might not. Things are different now, but our DNA are not. I'm going to think like an animal and follow our biological evolutionary tendency.
So to think like an animal, I look into the natural science world. I did some research on Logseq. To conduct any of those researches, I really like to just put a list of questions with my directional links under the creativity inbox or question curiosity inbox. For me to track questions that I want to answer, or I just chuck a link to articles that I find interesting. Here's the fun research to illustrate this example. Once upon a time in Cape Town, there were some great white shark bodies that were washed up the shore. They only have their liver dug out. The accuracy of surgical excision of the liver is so accurate. Who the heck in the marine kingdom does this? Throughout those papers and articles, it turned out that orcas understand that great white sharks are a type of animal that if they stop swimming, they will stop breathing. Orcas will work together to flip the great white shark on its belly, drown it, and then excision and harvest the liver. And then the body just gets floating in the ocean and gets washed up to the shore of Cape Town. Why do they like to eat the liver? Liver contains a lot of high fat and cholesterol, and same with humans. From an evolutionary standpoint, we want to survive and hunt for food. We're lazy by nature. We don't want to expenditure on energy. So how does the orca and human's brain does this? Two parts of the brain that are involved in planning and accessing value are the orbital prefrontal cortex and bilateral prefrontal cortex. First, the orbital prefrontal cortex is the part of the brain that determines is this goal valuable or not, and if there's immediate reward for me after completing task. Second, bilateral prefrontal cortex helps us to plan the task in terms of time frames. It can be 1 month, 2 weeks, or 3 days, depending on the length of our project. And this is also the part of the brain that helps us to overcome any automatic or habitual actions. And lastly, we've got to add in that super famous little element in the brain. Does anyone know what that's called? Amygdala. This is part of the brain that works with the OFC, or orbital prefrontal cortex, to make you into a mood and fear the consequences of not completing this task. I will go through a simple example of going to a supermarket to illustrate all the simple functions and principles that
the brain uses.
Second, we're gonna determine our desirable work outcome. Through the pandemic, I've went through a lot of identity crises. Through those crises, I have developed a fun habit. This habit is keep on redefining what I do. This is a adopt mental model from their famous angel investor in America called Naval Ravikant. So to scope this mental model from Naval Ravikant into more of a daily activity, values of going to supermarket is to enjoy freedom, get some food, and get fresh air, and to live as a human.
I'm to go out wearing my shoes right now in like proper human clothes in like 2 months.
Hey, I should chime in for some context to see what the heck is going on.
Each family can only have one person to leave the house, and this is the ticket to get out, and then they will rip this little part off and we'll see what happens. And
since the parameters of this project of leaving the compound to go to the grocery store is limited from 1 to 5 p.m. the defined outcome is to buy and feed myself a ton of junk food and come back by 5 p.m. And after we have defined our outcome, it is time to make the details plan. How detailed should our plan go? An interesting study compared two groups of people who want to do more recycling work in their office. The group who were given specific instructions had an increase of actionability towards their recycling goal by 100-fold. This is freaking remarkable. Like when I look at the study, like this like little hack that we have in our brain. As we go through a ritual and make through those plans, our body will build that emotionality and put ourselves into the motivation mood. Those are two handy dandy mental models that I use to choose the apps for organization note taking and where whatever thoughts or organization needs to go to. Back in the good old days where I can travel and actually go outside and be crazy, I remember when the flight is about to take off and the world becomes smaller and smaller. I see how tiny the city is and how insignificant my problems are. I imagine that I'm trying to figure out my life on the plane, and this is exactly what we do in top-down processing. Use our past experiences and expectations to plan. I got to top down and think of the whole project as a big timeline. I will detach myself from this project, just like how I detach myself from my earthly insignificant problems. And when I see the city that I live in from top down in a plane, and I feel like a tourist even going to the supermarket. How do I plan? How do I pick the foods? Use the advanced to-do list in here. So first, for going to a supermarket, I will Google how long it actually takes to ride my bicycle, because I can only scan a QR code and get out of the compound with those sharing bicycles.
Oh my gosh, this is probably a bad vlogging time, but you know, haircutting time.
It turned out that I need around 45 minutes to get to a supermarket in a mall called Wanxiang City. Next, I will look at my Notion database to look at my previous grocery shopping list to see what I like. I will plan according to that. And next, I'll do a obstacle identifying journaling exercise. One study found that people can triple their amount of daily project process by just foreseeing what obstacles and challenge they will face. And yeah, that's also where Logseq's note template function comes in handy. And the three steps are, first, write down the few goals that you're gonna achieve for that day, obviously. Second, run through some thought experiments of possible challenges and obstacles that you encounter. Third is describe how you will overcome those obstacles and challenges. So since Shanghai is under lockdown, these are some of foreseeable challenges: that QR codes, checkups, tickets that I need to return, and doing rapid antigen test after I come back from the grocery store to enter the compound. During this top-down process, don't try to make a perfect plan. This is not the point of the exercise. Yeah, we just have to get the work done. Thinking through the process is a lot better than not going through this top-down process at all. And get rid of your shitty perfectionism mindset, and I tend to fall into the overthinking. And yes,
when I'm in the supermarket, how will I process all those sensory information such as sight and smell
of all this glamorous food?
So I'll switch to bottom-up processing. There are three characteristics bottom up. First is focusing on sensory inputs. Second is real time. Third one is making adjustments as I go. Grocery store and have like that impulse to like buy something, but I don't want to fall on that impulse. I'm a little hamster or squirrel who likes to store for the winter and feel secure. Like, I will order some snacks and just looking at them makes me feel secured. When I shop, I will have a lot of random thoughts of what I want to buy and what foods I can make. There are tons of possibilities when vision senses come in as I shop. I will use the Logseq phone app to jot down things in the daily notes page and not worry about where this note fits into my system. I will group similar word lists by indenting them in. So to put this bottom-up processing and top-down thingy in a wider context, those two mental models is what determines what apps I use depending on the phase of the project that I am in. If I have a past experience on doing the project, I will use Notion because this app is more of a top-down approach. I can design any system inside and use a top-down approach to see what datas, what connections, what structure I have for this project. Whatever the outcome of the task is very unclear, I'll use bottom-up processing to fill in the gaps that are unique for this project in Logseq. When I have a problem, open Logseq and use obstacle journaling or do some research on how to overcome. Those are the two lenses that I shift when I do projects, by looking at the big end product and then doing each step on the go with bottom-up processing. I will not be a man with a hammer. If I have more than one mental model, I can look at the world with many different perspectives. Top-down and bottom processing of organization, I can switch between apps freely and let go of my expectations, information hoarder behaviors, and put my energy on the places where I need the most. And yeah, a filming break. You guys know this. This is called Three Brothers French Fries. So here, now I have defined my values of the project, the desirable outcome, steps, mental models to do the planning, and then we are going to put everything together. So first, let's define a value of a study session. I'll gain insights about a new topic, have a new lens to look at the world. Third, do better on my test. Second, the outcome of a study session is to gain a deep conceptual understanding of a chapter or topic of study to a point that I can explain the materials to a beginner. Since I am going back to dental school soon, I'll use endodontics as an example. First, I'll look through the learning objectives from the syllabus, textbooks, guides to grasp what are the learning objectives that the dental field study requires me to have. Second, I check my school calendar of assignments, projects, and presentations, but for this case, I am not having any school assignments. I am just reviewing for my return to dental school. Secondly, I will check my space revision schedule and make sure that I have reviewed all my material and not fallen behind with the space repetition schedule. It's very important to have like a strong base of past knowledges in order to learn faster and faster. I'll feel that compound effect keep on going. So third one is that I will gather learning resources from the internet. I tend to not find lecture slides and lectures just enough because I like to tackle the information from multiple different angles to not fall into the lens perspective of how the information is first framed for me. I like to push methods of framing the information is an easy way for me to understand right away. If I don't understand this resource, what's the point of reading it? Throughout the years of the mysterious algorithm and wasting my time scrolling on my phone, I've collected a long list of database for dental school. Fourth is I will foresee some possible hard concepts that I might encounter. I'll do this in Logseq with my obstacle journaling template. Here, I'll just type down some of the content that I think that my mind will have a hard time wrapping around it. For all the steps I have just mentioned here, checking my learning objectives, resources, websites, and notes, all those things, I'll put it into a template in Logseq when I need to learn. I'll just type template study and print this checklist out whenever I need to study so I don't miss any of those things. And they are automatically date stamps because I put them into a date journal. And sometimes I'll also tag dental school so I can track my study process and work log in Logseq. Depending on my previous knowledge that I have, I might also study multiple chapters at once, but this really depends on the complexity or foreseeable challenges. And then with all those intense prep work, my brain is loaded and my emotion is charged from doing all those actions to have the motivation. I will be finishing this task with a breeze! And yeah. And then when I start, I'll use my iPad to draw mind maps, reading different sources and see how the knowledge structure plays out in my brain. And secondly, this is my other day of doing content creation work and apps I use. I'll also go through a rigorous planning process. On outside, they look very different to studying, but the core concepts are the same. We want long-standing ideas. I don't want to always be learning new things on time. That is very, very tiring. Here is how I plan my process of writing videos. First, I use Readwise as my highlight manager tool. I highlight things, and this is my little personal assistant app that cites my resources and sync everything to Logseq. Second one is my thought tracking app, Logseq. I can use bi-directional linking to link all my nodes of thoughts and connections together. And then I use Notion for scripting. So the outcome of writing a script is to develop an idea that I think is valuable to my assumed group of audience on YouTube. First step, I'll open up my Notion database and just start a new template for my video idea. This document title will just be a random idea that I have in my mind. Second is to generate a one sentence summary of my video. When I generate ideas, I'll run through a bunch of thought experiments, possibilities of how I want to visualize and present this idea in a video. This comes with a lot of intense conditions, like if A happens, what would B happen? Third, if I'm running out of inspirations, I will flip through my unprocessed highlights and notes that I have in Logseq, where I can just explore my thoughts and connections freely. And when I feel that uncertainty is kicking in and I am procrastinating again because the orbital prefrontal cortex don't know what is the value of doing this work, I will reframe this creative explorative planning process into an escape. The mind is a very powerful tool. It is all about how I can reframe. I'll group all those tiny bits of atomic information together into a coherent point that I want to address. Seems like this video only makes sense to me at the moment, so system is to generate the thumbnail and the title of this video. I have to think from the audience's shoes and see how they might understand this video. This is all a bunch of thought experience and assumptions. I have to exercise my judgment when it comes to making a thumbnail and title. There's no right answer, but there's only a best way to deliver this. Like, this is a video of me posing for a thumbnail. I know it's very awkward and cringe, but hey, yeah, this is all the behind the scenes for you being a YouTuber, huh? I'll try to see how this idea makes sense from a marketing perspective so the audience and algorithm can understand what the heck I'm doing. And then seventh step is writing out the script or the article that I like. And I still have to adjust this outline as I go along and edit. I try to minimize the amount of time I edit. Yeah, and yeah, this is why creative work is so hard. The exploratory phase is inherently not feeling productive to the orbital prefrontal cortex. And the basic things are like, no, I'm not gonna do this. I'm not gonna go and put in my energy for developing this idea. But, you know, hey, that's how creativity works. There are two phases of creativity, the exploratory phase and the execution phase. And here, I'm mostly talking about the exploratory phase since the uncertainty and rewards of the idea are so unclear. I have literally planned the whole process, literally plan all the bits of information I want to deliver and how I want to deliver, how I want to market it. All of those prep work in the exploratory phase will pay off and making the exploratory phase more streamlined. And I can finish this video and deliver it to you guys. And here's another video on video with neuroscience tips on how I focus and always keep that kindling curiosity fire going. And thank you so much for watching. I will see you guys next time. Bye bye. Oh my gosh, I am all about this haircut trend.